Hello all, this is Damini. I welcome you to our new series, Discover Study Abroad, a talk show where I'll be personally discussing with a few students who have made it through the entire journey of applying to study abroad. We will be discussing various steps and experiences of their journey, which will give you interesting insights and learnings. So today our first show is with Yash Nag, who is studying at Loughborough University in the UK. So hi Yash, this is Damini, and thanks for taking our time for this call. So how are you doing today?
I'm doing good. Actually, I just moved here in UK, and after completing my isolation, now I'm in my student accommodation. I'll be starting soon with my lectures. So I'm pretty adapting to the weather here exactly because I come from Mumbai, and here it's pretty cold. So it's like 3, 2 and zeros also.
Okay. Yeah, UK must be like pretty cold now, like February. So yeah. I hope you're adapting to that. Yeah. Okay. So you are now in the student accommodation. So are you like finding it comfortable or are you like, you know, finding a little different nationalities, diversity? So do you have any friends over there already?
Yeah, I have a friend who was with me in my undergrad. So he's in the next apartment. I was there for some time also. Like I was staying in my room, but I was eating out with them. But like now I'm in my room and I cook with my other friends who are in my apartment. And it's better to have international friends rather than like having the same friends like back home. Like, yeah, it is actually having international friends or maybe local. It's pretty much more helpful because they know stuff around and like, you know, you get to know like my friend here. He has been here since September, like someone in my apartment. So he's from undergrad. So he knows like where we can find cheap groceries or something like that. And like expenses are a big aspect for students. So that's also important.
I think that's probably the best part of making new friends with, you know, locals.
Yes.
You get to know like a lot of local things. Yeah. Okay. So Yash, let's start this, talk for today. So first of all, I mean, can you give me a little background of yourself? Like where do you hail from and a little bit about your family maybe?
Yeah, so I was born and brought up in Mumbai. And like my parents, my mom is a housewife and my dad works in creative services in Star Sports channel. And I completed my graduation like recently in October because I had actually different plans. I was supposed to go to go to Ireland in September for my master's in a different university. Okay. But then because I did not get my final semester results and all that time, so I had to get a refund of my deposit. And then I switched my plans to UK and I applied here and now I'm here. So it was all a sudden shift because I had never decided even in my wildest dreams that I'll be coming to UK for my master's. But now I'm here.
Okay. Sure. So, I mean, it got shifted from September 2020 to,
Jan 2021.
The whole COVID thing and everything.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so also the country's changed from Ireland to UK.
But I think UK has a lot of opportunities now. But
it does.
The time will tell that once you graduate, you know, what kind of opportunities you're able to secure. So, but I think as of now, I mean, it's kind of trending, people going to UK. So, yeah. So what was your parents like, you know, were they kind of positive about you studying abroad or how did they perceive the whole idea of you planning to study abroad?
So the thing was when I was in my junior college in 12th standard, I had gone to a study tour to USA with my college. So we had like a 10 or 11 days tour where we visited different universities and we learned how things are taught there and how the study universities abroad work. So at that time I was kind of interested and my parents were also interested, but that time I got an acceptance for my undergrad in a university in US. But then the amount that was like pretty expensive because it was crossing 1 crore 20 lakhs. So I was like, I don't want to do this right now. So I was thinking of going to Canada for my diploma something courses that I was seeing at PG diploma things. But then I thought that I had already done my 1 year of undergraduation by the time I received acceptances for Canada and all. So I was like, why go for a diploma program now when I can do more 2 years and get my degree here? So that's what my even parents and teachers suggested, and that's why I was waiting. But then I had a plan that I might go to Canada for PG diploma after my graduation. Mm-hmm. But a senior of mine, he was going to Ireland last year. Like, he went last year. So he suggested that, why are you going to Canada and like wasting so much time when you could go to another country and get a master's degree in just 1 year, and that to a degree over a diploma. So I thought, yeah, that's fine. Then I applied to Ireland, but then all the sudden shift in September, and then in September I changed my plans to UK and I applied here and got accepted.
Okay, so I think your parents were always they had the idea of
you. Yeah, they were always supportive.
So I mean, when you know you were planning for the same for after your undergrad, so I think they knew that you know you're gonna study abroad. So I think they were kind of okay with it, right? So
Because I was like, when I was doing my undergraduation, I was always applying, I was giving exams, IELTS and all. So like, I have given now so many entrance exams now. So it had to be done. Like, so.
Got it.
Yeah.
So I mean, you have scored a pretty good score in IELTS also, which I, you know, I could see in your profile. You have got 7.5 band. So how was it? Like, how many months did you prepare, and how was like the whole process of IELTS preparation?
I am not going to lie, but like, this was my second attempt at IELTS. In 2017, when I was applying to Canada, like, I was literally, I had already applied and got acceptances also. So I had to give IELTS back then. So even then, I took around only like 14 days to prepare. And at that time also, I had scored the same 7.5. So now when I was applying for Ireland, I knew that my scores were going to expire because it has only like 2 years validity. So I had given SATs before for USA. Then I gave IELTS in the same year. But then in 2019, I gave IELTS again. And even then, this time I knew from where I have to study. So like, there is this Cambridge assessment book. I like practiced around three or four tests from that book, and I was fine.
I think that book which they send you like along with when you book for IELTS, that book you're talking about.
Yeah, right? So the first time that I gave IELTS in 2017, that was a paper-based one. At that time, they had sent me a book. But when I gave it now, it was a computer-delivered one. So they did not give me a book in 2019. It was just the online material that was like one or two tests. But I guess the book pretty much helped.
Yeah. Okay. Even I used that.
So I gave like three or four tests in that from that book and one test online because I needed to know that how the online system would work. So coming from a technical background, it did not matter me. Like, it did not affect me much. But then I had to know that how it works. And the best part about IELTS computer delivered is that the speaking session still stays in person to person. Like, you have an interviewer and you have to go and speak to them. So it's fine.
Okay. So I mean, any tips? I think probably this is one of the tips which you told that you know, the Cambridge book which they send, that we should.
Yeah, the Cambridge Academic Language Assessment book.
Yeah. So is there that you would want to advise like other people? Because see, IELTS is one, you know, one exam which a lot of people are scared of. I know that, you know, people do score, but
yeah, it's an important factor.
Yeah. So when they start attempting it the first time, I think a lot of people are very scared of it. So is there any tip, you know, you want to give them like to make the journey of IELTS preparation a little more smoother for them?
Yeah, so the first thing I would suggest is start with the easier websites. Like, you will find IELTS Up and IELTS Ninja, these two websites to be very helpful. But the thing is, the difficulty level of these tests on these websites is very low. You cannot just rely on that. Then once you are like okay with that and you are done with that, then you can start the Cambridge books. And for in-person speaking to speaking, like, sorry, in-person interview, for speaking test, you have to like talk to a friend or a mentor or a teacher, because that's the best possible way that I can do. Because I have taught a few friends of mine, like I have helped them in speaking and all. So it was always on call, or it was like we were meeting, and then I used to ask, because the Cambridge book does have speaking section and there's like cards which has questions on it, and your friend can just ask you and you could answer it. And make sure you do not repeat your vocabulary. You have a wide range of words, and plus you know what the words mean. You just cannot insert any word in place of anything.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah, and as the speaking test, you know, in actual also is going to be face-to-face. So I think that always, you know, it's a very good tip that, you know, to practice is also, we should practice with other people. So
yes.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
So Yash, now I want to ask you, like, what made you decide to study abroad? I mean, you did tell me, like, you were planning even during your undergrad, but then, was there any particular reason that you decided, okay, you should study abroad instead of, let's say, pursuing higher education in India?
Yeah, so the first thing was I was looking at the opportunities available for me, and plus the course that I'm doing here, it is IT with business both. This is very uncommon in India. It's like I'll have to search, I don't know how many universities, and still won't be able to find it. So like that was also a pretty much deciding factor for me. And also I have a few friends studying abroad in like US, Canada, UK also. So I have seen their journey and it was pretty much good. So that's why I decided that I will pursue this.
And I think your course is another important thing, right? So you chose this course. So,
Yes.
which university you are studying? I think I forgot to ask you at the start of the session.
Yeah, I'm studying at Loughborough University and my course is MSc Information Management and Business Technology.
Okay, so I think that's a probably very unique kind of course. So, like, are there
Yes.
a lot of UK universities which offer this course, or did you find it only like in a couple of universities?
Yeah, so the thing in abroad universities is you will find courses, but like what you like and all, but the thing is that you cannot just rely on the course name. You have to check the modules. If because the thing is, when I was looking for Ireland, so I was looking at a course which had a similar module, but its name was different. It was completely different. It was MSc Digital Innovation. So when I was searching here, I was searching the same name, but then when I realized that okay, the courses are in different names also, so I started seeing the modules and all, like opening new tabs, opening 20, 30, 50 tabs. I remember when I started the application process and everything. And then I got my perfect course. So then I applied.
So you were very particular that this is what you want to study and this is what the course should
Yes.
contain, right? Okay, got it.
Yes, exactly.
Sure. So that makes I think the viewers should learn something. Even I, always advise that, worry, like, you should be concerned about what the course contains rather than just the title. And I think you have probably portrayed it in a very
Yeah.
good way. Sure. So I think now, Yash, I will ask you a couple of questions with respect to your loan
All right.
process because you have got your loan sanctioned via vMake Scholars. So I could see that in your profile that, for a very long time that the loan process was going ahead with SBI and the lawyer was just putting new requirements in terms of documents in front of you. So, and I think
Exactly.
that whole thing went on for a very long time. So did you feel like, was there any time in the whole process with this SBI thing that, you felt that, this loan is not gonna work out for me? So were you like hopeless anytime in the process?
Yeah, so the whole month of November went less like this only. I was hopeless the whole month of November. We were like looking at different things, and then in the end, like we had funds, but we were not pretty much sure about using it. So we were looking for a loan. And I'm like, to be very honest, I started this loan process last January. And this is
Last
this
year.
January. So I started, yeah. So I got an acceptance back in October 2019 for
Okay.
Ireland.
Okay.
Then
So
I waited for a
Ireland was
while.
different back then. Okay.
Okay, yeah. So I got my acceptance in October 2019. Then in January 2020, I started my loan process and everything. I took pretty much good time, like for 1 month or something, because the thing was I was in my final semester in my undergrad. So I was very busy at that time because of my final project and everything. So it took me like around 1, 1.5 months to gather all the documents that they required. I submitted around like I literally serial numbered all the documents and I submitted 42 documents to SBI. And later, then the lockdown happened and everything. So I was like, okay, let's see where this goes because we did not know. It was uncertain that when it will open and everything. So things started getting back on track in June
And
when
it seems
they
like
were
the
like,
lockdown extended like for a pretty long time, right? And I think you were in Mumbai, right, at that point of time? So
I
went on
was at my
to
home because even my undergrad exams were left. Like I was done with four exams, but my practical and one theory paper was remaining. So I was there. So like after that, it took me a while. So in June, I got to know that there were some like because they declined my application in June. So maybe I thought because it was of the duration and it might have expired after the lockdown and all because see, we give a post-dated checks for processing fees and everything. So I thought because of its validity ended, they might have done that. And I had spoken to them. So they were like, okay, if you're changing anything, we could just get back on track. I had like included BMX scholars in this. So they were talking to bank. Okay. And we went forward and everything. But then I was like, okay, let's do this. Let's wait, because I don't know when my exams are going to happen, because there was a lot of uncertainty about exams and everything. So it's like, I don't want to go again to the...
And then you must be unsure at that point of time whether I can fly abroad, because all the countries are in lockdown. So yeah.
Yes, exactly. So I was like, I'll wait because if I go again and do all the documentation, like it was a hassle. So I was like, let's keep it like that. And then when I'm okay with it, when we know that, okay, I can go, that time I'll resume it. Okay. So after a month or something, I was like, okay, let's resume it. So then, but in September, we knew that I won't be able to fly for my September intake. So because even after that, the university was okay with us flying late for 2 or 3 weeks, but then that did not make sense to us. So we were like, okay, let's wait another year, because they don't have January intakes. So I was like, okay, let's see what goes. And I had asked the bank that I might continue, and I was like, since the doc like processes for like it goes long, and your sanction letter validity is also 6 months. So I was like, okay, we can start maybe in December for next year, like for September 21. Okay. But then apparently I had told them, okay, I'm changing my plans and I'm going to another university in September only, when I got my acceptance. So Tarun was like a vital, Tarun played a vital role, who was the agent for
that
BMX
was my
scholars.
Next question to you, like, you know, even though it didn't happen in SBI eventually. So do you think, like, you know, Tarun, Ruben, who were in touch with you from, you know, from the in-office team, and, you know, Furkan, who was in touch with you from on-field, like, were they actually, because now as you are elaborating it, the whole thing was a kind of a chaos, right? So were they helpful
or
did they play any significant role in the entire process for you?
The thing was, when I started, I had a different agent. Like I had to change, like go through 3 agents because of the, like, because of the lockdown and everything. And then according to my area and everything. So I spoke to Furkan, I spoke to Ruben, I spoke to Tarun. They were all amazing. Like they have helped me so much, and especially Tarun. So Tarun was always there whenever I'm calling him, or whenever I leave a message, he used to call back, and we would get the same thing done on the same day. So he was talking to Furkan. He was also talking to bank. So in October, so there was a point, like I got COVID. In mid-September, I tested positive for COVID when I had my exams. I was in the isolation center. And like this was just after receiving my acceptance. Like after like 5 days of receiving my acceptance, I was COVID positive. So I was moved to an isolation center, and I was appearing for my exams from there. So I had told Tarun that, like I have my exams right now. I'll contact you next week when I'm done, so that we can take this forward for UK. Okay. So I started with that, and I had sent him already, like my all documents were in SBI since January 2020. So I sent him my new offer letter, all the requirements that were there, the new updated scores and everything. So he started the process, but then when I came back in October, in mid-October, they told me that like there's an issue with your document and you have to get it changed. When they told me that, I was like, when they were saying that, I was like, okay, it's pretty chill. I can get it done and it will be okay. Yeah. But then when we started the process, it was a very big hassle. Like I had to go through different agents, I had to go myself, like my parents had to use contacts and everything in the registrar office.
Legal documents, right? About the property they were
It was a property document. It was a very old document actually, and it was, see, the property that I was mortgaging, I was like, my father was the third owner of it.
Okay.
And the document had issue in the first agreement that was between the builder and the first owner.
Okay.
So the registrar was like, you have to speak to,
right? I mean, for such an old document, it must have been difficult for you to get it corrected.
Exactly. And like, it's still not corrected to just add the update. Like the registrar was like, you have to get the builder, you have to get the first owner, and no one has contacts with like such old, like we didn't even have the contact of the person from whom we bought the flat, because it's been so long. We bought it in 2014. So it was a very big hassle. And then we spoke to the lawyer And at one, so one day after like, after going through all this hassle, mm-hmm. after like 3 or 4 days, mm-hmm. we spoke, my dad spoke to the lawyer, and mm-hmm. she was fine with me making an indemnity bond.
Okay.
But okay. then what happened was, so I had my own lawyer. So mm-hmm. they also spoke to the lawyer and they were like, yeah, you can make, first she declined. But later when my dad spoke to her, she was fine with an indemnity bond. So oh. like the same day we got that indemnity bond ready. Mm-hmm. And when we were about to go to the bank, like I was literally wearing my shoes to go to the bank. She's mm-hmm. calling me back again. And I was like, why is she calling me now?
Mm-hmm.
So she's like, I went through your documents and it seems to be a vital mistake. So that is why I cannot accept the indemnity bond either. You have to get it corrected.
The lawyer.
Yeah, the lawyer.
The bank, SBI Impact.
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Yeah. So,
yeah,
and I'll tell you what the issue was, okay? It is, so the person who did the agreement was old. It was from 1998.
Mm-hmm.
So the person who wrote the number in that document, mm-hmm. it was 4, but it literally looked like 001. And my flat number was 004. So oh. that is where the issue happened. And it was like only one place that was also not in the proper agreement. It was in the index 2. Yeah. So it was in index 2. So like my dad got frustrated and everything. That day we went to SBI, the main center, the RACPC center where they process the loan and everything.
Mm-hmm.
My dad spoke to the officer there also. Like Furkan played a vital role when we were speaking to them.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we submitted all the documents also before, they were like, no, we won't do this. And the lady was like, you can send it to another lawyer. We can send it, send these documents to another lawyer. And then they might, they will go through it. But then the point here was the first lawyer had sent my documents with a letter head that contained the mistake.
Okay.
Like what was the issue with the documents?
Mm-hmm.
If you're sending that letter again to another lawyer, why will they not check that issue and why will they like ignore it? So it did not make sense and it would take another 2 weeks and I was supposed to arrive here in January.
Yeah.
At that time I was thinking of leaving in mid-December, so that time we did not have time, plus that it was the Diwali week, so
mm-hmm.
there was no time at all. And then I moved on with NBFCs.
So yeah, so that was my actually next question to you, that you know, even before, while this whole SBI thing was going on, we had this kind of sense that, you know, it may not happen in SBI. Even Tarun could
yes.
say that, because they were, you know, literally asking so many documents and they were pointing out things in property, which of course, you know, we generally cannot argue with them on, because they are like, oh, this property is not legally valid and things like that.
Exactly.
So, yeah. So, and at that point of time, even before, you know, SBI rejected it, we gave you an NBFC backup option. So do you think it's a good idea rather than, you know, waiting for one bank to reject and then coming up with the backup option? So do you think it's a good idea to have a backup, you know, if you're able to sense that, you know, things with the first bank may or may not happen? So what is your take on that?
So what happened was, as you spoke about evaluation, legal and terms. So my property evaluation was done back in July.
Mm-hmm.
Like when the lockdown was lifted and things started to get back on track, my property evaluation was done. It was just the lawyer's issue that was pending. And the thing was, if they could have informed me this back in June when they rejected my application, they could have told me about it. But I got to know this in October, that through via the manager calling me one day early morning. And she's like, there's a mistake with our document.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, let's see. So at that point of time only, before even when I was applying with SBI, my dad was not very much positive about it. He was like, we can go to another banks. Why do you want to go to SBI? Because it's a very big hassle. So see, I told you, like I submitted 42 documents and even after that, there are issues. And it was not like it was only me.
Like,
I have my two friends.
Hmm.
Yeah, I have my two friends who applied to SBI too via VMAX Scholars, my referrals.
Hmm.
But then even they faced issues. But luckily they were fortunate enough that in the end, they were able to present those letters, the things that SBI demanded at the very last moment.
Mm-hmm.
And like, they were able to make it. So now they are in the UK with me.
Okay. So
not with me, they are fine. Like,
so both of them have got it from
SBI. Yeah, they both got it from SBI. But the thing was that it was there that I applied through multiple NBFCs.
Yeah,
so it was pretty much good that Tarun was there And then he was always checking on that which NBFC is offering what deal and what are their pros and cons and benefits and how is their repayment tenure going to affect me and everything.
So, I mean,
it's better to
negotiate finally. I mean, could he bring down the NBFC interest rate and, you know, other terms for you? Could he make it better?
Yeah, it was like the best one, to be very honest. So there were two NBFCs that were literally fighting for me, I guess.
Okay.
So one would come up with a better deal and then the second one would decrease their interest rate and affect the processing fees and everything. And then the first one would go back, okay, listen, we can offer this. So then the second one also would come up with something. So at one point I was saturated. I was like, okay. There was a point I was like, okay, let's see who is offering a better deal to me. Yeah. I checked and then the processing fees was an important aspect back then because I had to pay it upfront. And the NBFC I went with, it offered me a very big,
discount on that.
Like a discounted price, I would say, because of the loan amount and all I was taking. So they offered me an amazing deal. So it was like literally done in December.
You know, once you get a deal from one NBFC, we try to see that, you know, if there is anyone who can beat the deal kind of thing. So I think that's what Tarun was trying to do to make sure that, you know, you get the best possible terms. So, So my last question is going to be like, you know, how was your whole interaction with the VMAX Scholars team? Can you point out some of the best things you felt in the whole interaction?
Yeah, so my first agent was Saptarishi when I started with VMAX Scholars back in January 2020. And at that time, I had full hopes that I would go to Ireland and the loan will be via SBI and everything. But now nothing is the same.
Okay.
And then I had a different agent because due to some issues, Saptarishi left. So then I had Tarun. And then even because of some personal issues, even Tarun was not there for a while in between. And then it was a genuine issue. It was like a very big issue at that time. So then I had someone from like other team. But then Rubin was also there all like at all times when Tarun was not there. And even he was helping me. In the end, I was talking to Ravi, who was the manager over there. And then when Tarun came back to office, I was like, I requested them that please assign my file back to Tarun. Because he knows all the details that I have gone through in the past year and everything. So then I went ahead with Tarun. And like Tarun played a very important role, like from getting it disbursed to checking the discounted prices and everything. He was always there.
I'm very glad to hear that you know, you had a good experience, even though, you know, the SBI part was kind of, you know, it went up a little messed up, but I'm glad that you're happy with the VMAX Scholars team and Tarun especially. So that's it. Yash, I think the last question would be, you know, what are your future aspirations? Because now you are there in the UK at Loughborough University. So what exactly, and, you know, you are doing the course, which, you know, you wanted to. So what are your future aspirations and, you know, where you want to take it to?
I have not yet decided as such, but I'll be looking at the graduate prospects since my university, Loughborough University's graduate career prospects are amazing in the UK. And my university is rated like number 4 in the UK. So they have a pretty much a good number of options available for us, Loughborough students. So I'll look into the employment status and everything. I might do that. And later, I plan on doing a PhD. But I'm not yet sure about it because I have to repay the loan and everything. And even I have to like do some savings and everything so that I can go for a PhD, right? It's not such an easy process to just get a PhD. So like,
So sure, Yash, I wish you good luck to get a, you know, fully funded PhD also so that you don't have to rely on any external funding at that point of time because PhD has to be fully funded. So good luck with that. Good luck with your course. And it was very nice interacting with you. I hope, you know, our viewers will learn a lot from your journey. So thank you very much.
So I started learning actually from your documentary from your YouTube channel, Loan Flex, that series. I started learning and I got to know the differences and everything, like how to do the process and everything. I've literally watched all the videos. So that's what my start was. And I did not expect that someday I will be talking to you and it like this. And so, so it was fine. It was amazing. Actually, your YouTube channel helped me a lot to begin with.
Sure. Thank you. Yes. So thanks very much for appreciating that. So thank you.
Don't forget to subscribe and click on the bell icon to never miss any updates from us.